simply going to remind us of our ground rules for our conversations and learning things with the days of story stay here, to share the air, to challenge yourself to be respectful of the only cheerful moments, preserve the right to change your mind about what you think you hear. Remember, it's not just the intent that matters, but also the impact. Be the expert of your experience and design statements. Leave space for processing before, after, inside, and outside of this room. Make sure you take care of yourself. And ultimately, this is partially a lesson in practicing vulnerability for all of us that are here. With that in mind, our guest storyteller that we're about to introduce has chosen not to have her story publicly shared, so we're going to turn off the video for that portion of the presentation before she arrives. And so maybe Chris is okay if I have to shut off the video now. I have had the great privilege. So one of the things that I really attempted to do in acting for this business school offering is try to overplan so that I can be pretty adaptable to whatever the space presents itself. And so, particularly with honoring people's ability to tell their stories, for people to be able to interact with them, I'll move forward with an exercise that I was going to do. And then I think we will just move into some of the content to try to make up some time. And I'm going to grab around some of my notes. And, you know, for many of us in the room, I had an acute awareness that, as I said at the very beginning of this business school offering, that I am certainly not the expert. You know, I have my own worldview, my own perspective, and I continue to dive into each of these subject matters. In particular, what I found really interesting was in reading a book by Michael Heck that has been edited called Communicating Prejudice. He actually went out and engaged in some conversations, and he was talking with some folks, and he asked the woman in particular to visualize class. And so when she thought about the concept of class in general, what is it that came to her mind? How does she describe class? And this is exactly what she said. She said, well, in thinking about the working class, I see people sitting around in a bar, drinking, watching television, and laughing, and carrying on loudly. A middle-class environment is more of a cocktail. Maybe the television is on, but it's quieter. It's the news as opposed to a sports event that you would see in a working class bar. And the people are drinking something other than beer, maybe wine. And they're sitting around in a circle discussing things pleasantly. Upper class people, they don't really go out. They're sitting around in their drawing rooms, sipping fine port and talking about something intellectual like art, literature, or something like that. And as I reflected on the narrative or this interview or this story, I began to think about all the ways in which class, whether it be economic or social, begins to get represented and becomes a part of our indelible memories. And I really began to think, if you had asked me to describe the different classes, I might not have come up with something that was too different than what she shared or described. So then, when we think about classism in the news, this is actually a direct quote from the Minneapolis Star Tribune. And what I found really striking here is that at the end of the day, perhaps the most elusive of all our social constructions confronting us today is the issue of class. It can evade attempts at categorization or simplistic definition. The issues and problems of class struggle cuts across the social dimensions of race and ethnicity, of sex, gender, and sexuality, of able body or disabled body, national and geographic origin, educational background, and even marriage and parental status. it really affects everyone and where you are and all of your identities very differently. So when I thought about trying to define class and come up with the best definition that I could find out there about class, I really had a great appreciation for the education that I learned from seeking out classism.org. It's a really great resource to give you, I think, some very simplistic ways to wrap your head around something that I think is a very complicated issue or construct. So basically, what they talk about as class, and what we mean by class, is its relative social rank in terms of wealth, income, property ownership. And they'll talk about that as the owning class and the class who does not own. Job status, education, skills, or power in both economic and political spheres. And that really started to resonate with me. And it's not determined just by economic capital, what you earn or own, but also by social capital, who you know, and what cultural capital, what you know. Further, they said that it affects us differently on a personal and emotional level, not just in economic terms. And it also influences how we feel about ourselves and others. And at the end of last week, as I introduced this topic, I said, even for myself, I actually, for a very long time, have been very stalwartly connected to what would be my lower class Appalachian cultural identity. And then for years and years, I have identified as middle class. That's where I think my values are. But as I really began to dig more deeply into this, I really have this huge awareness in the interest of transparency and practicing vulnerability that I was like, wow, I actually, from an economic perspective, am lower upper class or middle upper class, depending on how much income we're bringing in that is, where the interest in cuts. But that was a big reality for me because it really shook me up a bit to think that I'm not as closely connected to a middle class identity as I. And so what do we mean by classism? So classism comes when someone's just treated differently, better or worse, because of their class or perceived class. It's also similar in many ways to racism, sexism, heterosexism, and other forms of power and oppression. And actually, it influences our attitudes, our behaviors. It shows up institutionally through the policies and practices in our organizations. And then gets further communicated how we start to ascribe or buy into our norms and values and our institutions and social situations. It's a tendency to also make generalizations or stereotypes about people, such as poor people are lazy. That's something that we hear. And my video clip doesn't play very well, but I encourage you to go out and just Google David Lindsay Amer and Good People. And there's just a great 1 minute clip about this character, Maggie, in this play. And she comes across a physician. They grew up in South Bay, Boston. Her physician friend, who wanted to be a very successful cardiologist, and she has the most amazing 1 minute speech about, well, let me tell you why my life is difficult, because I care for a daughter who has an emotional disability. And then what happened is I had to pay a bill, and then I had a cracked tooth, which is why I had to wait because it got infected, and then I couldn't make my car payment because I finally had to have this happen. So it's this really great roller coaster in 1 minute. It's a powerhouse clip to watch. So ultimately, conceptualized class statuses are economic, income and wealth, political, power in the workplace, and in politics. Right? Who's the president of your organization? Who's the frontline worker doing the meat of the work every day? Those are different people. Cultural, again, education. Taste, communication, and lifestyle. So cultural classism is the way in which classism is manifested through our cultural norms and practices. It's rooted in ideology behind an idea. So again, as I share, it's solidly connected to my lower class, socioculturally, economic, disadvantaged, Appalachian identity. I can assure you we are storytelling people in ways with very clear ideas about what the rest of the world is like and not like. And even when I go home to visit now, people that I have known for 50 years, and saw me grow up as an infant, say, oh, you're no longer from here. And that actually hurts when I go home to visit, because I feel very connected to Appalachian in a very meaningful way. couple of classism examples. And this is by no means, since we're on videotape, say anything pejorative about GERR life insurance and the life insurance policy. But what I began to think about when I think about cultural communication of classism is, what is it communicating? Does it really say that you're a better mother or a better parent because you make a decision or you can afford to buy GERR life insurance? Well, does it guarantee that your baby will actually grow up somehow thrive or be better in the world? Or is it something that comes with status and privilege and wealth and other sociocultural belongings? But the purchasing of life insurance for your child can actually have a really interesting classism context, I believe. Credit score requirements, right? Which credit score? Is it 740, 780, or is it 200? And having been someone who had credit score one time in my life growing up and making bad decisions as a teenager, I think it was like 200 at one point, and now it's, you know, close to 800. So, well, the thing that doesn't take into consideration for really great people is your character. Will you pay that bill, regardless of your credit score? What kind of social network do you have to be able to become owning class versus non-owning class? And so credit score requirements, I think, are a really additional great example of cultural classism. We buy into it. Some of us willingly, some of us non-willingly. Right? If we own something and we want to sell it, we want to know maybe someone else's credit score before we make a decision to offer them that property. Lower funding in schools is another example. Schools that have higher wealth and socioeconomic privilege get higher funding, have maybe larger sports programs, have larger contributions both privately and publicly. Lower funded schools often have things cut for them, whether it be sports programs, arts programs, all those other kinds of things. So I think, again, another form of cultural classism. And then there's the assimilation practices. So yes, we want you to come join our school, our group, our club. But here are our rules, our expectations, how you should fit in, how you behave, what speaking up or speaking out looks like in each of those different situations and contexts, and how will change respond to you if you decide not to follow the rules. So some classist beliefs are individualism. This is individual interest or ought to be ethically paramount. Virtue of self-reliance, freedom from government, pursuit of economic goals. So this individual concept is certainly a very American concept. I also like to think of it as the concept of Americanization, right? We are what we produce, we value what we produce, and anybody here can do anything and be anything if you just pull yourself up by your own bootstraps. And you as an individual can change all of those things. But at the end of the day, also come to see that it's truly just a belief, because for some people, no matter how hard they try, it's not possible. And maybe they're just trying to have social mobility, and they are a product or a victim of social classism. There's also meritocracy. And meritocracy is really about a system in which talented or chosen or moved ahead on the basis of their achievements. So we hear a lot about this in upper echelon schools, where athletes and drug use on campuses, the rules are relaxed in those colleges. They have a lot more money, so that because of someone's donation to the organization, their child is kind of the heads turned the other way by the campus police and how they're held accountable for crimes, but then also in socioeconomically disadvantaged or challenged institutions, or particularly with those people of color, they are held more according to what the law is and can be judged criminally. And then also leadership can be selected on the basis of intellectual criteria. So how smart am I and how smart can I show that I am? And that can actually help me move along. And if we buy into that, meritocracy exists, but if we choose to challenge that construct, meritocracy can actually have a harder way to go. So as I continue to dive into this, I really thought it was important because we often will think of classism in terms of just the economic class. I really wanted to go out and do some research for myself. This is where my own are the wealthiest 1%. And what I thought was fascinating is that the annual income is just at least $389,000 in some change, right? So, and I thought, that's really not as high as I thought it was. Because for some people, when we think about Seattle in particular, or other large metropolitan cities, New York and Los Angeles, this is not a whole lot of money for some people. Because you will not live in an $8.5 million house on Park Avenue if you're making $389. But $389 is what puts you into the wealthiest 1%. The average income, though, for the top 1% is $1.1 million. The take home is 20.1% of all income for this upper class, wealthiest 1%. The upper middle class, this is a group of people who have 6.1%, they bring home $200,000 annually. So if your income, combined household income, regardless of size of family, is $200,000 or more, you actually are considered economically in the United States upper middle class. And 14.1% bring home between $100,000 and $150,000. So if you make greater than $100,000 in a year, you are considered upper middle class.
So how are you it might be something simple, just not seeing it, but how are you distinguishing annual income and average?
Well, so all of this comes from, I did a survey of just different U.S. economic websites to see what the average Gestalt was, to try to paint the best picture of it. And so what I found is that these were the numbers that different organizations attached to different wealth statuses, just financially. And to me, what I really took home, so if it's the wealthiest 1%, right? At the end of the day, there's someone who makes the most, and out of that, there's someone who makes the least. But in there, there's the average of what that is. So the wealthiest 1% is what that is. But the bare minimum to be upper class is $389.
Okay.
And then the average, though, is more than that.
Okay.
So there are more people who are making $1.1 million compared to the rest. Right? But it is 20.1% of total income. So that means 80% of the people in the United States are making less than that. But I thought, okay, well, who are those people? And that's where I discovered that upper middle is defined as just 200 or 100 to 150. And that's still a lot of people. But when you look at that, so that's 20, that's another 20, that's 40% of total income in the United States is upper middle and upper class. 60% of the people now start to fall below. And then this is where it becomes really interesting, is that the majority of people, when you look at all the U.S. economic websites and try to define classes, it becomes a really difficult thing to figure out. It's kind of a moving target. But the most fascinating thing I learned is that the majority of people in the United States, so I look at myself and say I definitely identify there, will say they are middle class, when in fact they are either above it or below it. So of the people they continue to survey and then look at actual income and how you live, your quality of life, so middle class accounts for 41.5% of households. The annual income is between $30,000 and $100,000, and this is where they start to define number of family members that you should be able to accommodate with that amount of money. And immediately I went, why would Seattle, if you're a family of three living on $30,000, I could hardly see that as a middle class. However, that's what is defined as kind of a general U.S. gestalt. You can begin to drill down and look at areas and cities and towns and locales and states and regions. So this is just kind of a high-level slice overview, if you will. So of that, though, 26% earn more than that, 32% earn less than that, and the lower middle class families earn between 18.8 and 47.1 for a family of three. And I was looking at it thinking, that is not a lot of money. Even if you live in an area like where I grew up in Appalachia, that is not a lot of money. Because I just went to an event this past weekend in Marion. It's a very nice building. The rent in that building is but it shows a group that's very interesting and complex Seattle marketplace. So poverty is defined as 14% or 43 million people currently in the United States. Here they add an extra family person. I found it interesting, the lower your income, the more people they begin to add in that you can identify by definitions. I don't know what that says to me yet. I'm still wrapping my head around it, but I thought the less money you make, the more people they add in, and then you should be able to live on that. The more money you make, the less people they add in, and you have more money. Very interesting to me. So for family of four, it's 24.2, and for family of three, it's 18.8. So what's the impact of this conversation about class and classism? So there's the poor and working class, and there's an impact for people who are identified or self-identify as poor and working class. And there can be an element of shame. You know, there's damage to the self-worth. There's also internalized classism, just like there is internalized ableism, internalized racism, internalized sexism. And people can feel inadequate. So if I can't even do this, why should I try anything else? And then there's some cultural markings developed that make it hard for individuals to overcome those hardships. But I also wanted to figure out what would be the impact of classism on the wealthy and owning class. Because there has to be an impact. Just because you're making money or a lot of money doesn't mean you're not impacted by the concept of classism. And what I found in my literature search and review is that there's an over-sheltering of that owning class. So this idea that maybe they'll become unaware or decrease awareness of their own privilege, or that there can be guilt, shame, and depression because I'm born into money and I have money, so what should I do with that? Or should I hoard it? You know, what does that mean? And also there can be a superiority of those who are poor or working class. So in the owning class, people sometimes think that they are better than someone else just because they make more money. And it was really important to me to try to paint a well-rounded picture of impact for both the poor and working class and the wealthy and owning class, because I don't think it's really one-directional or two-directional. Other ways that we communicate classism is geographic. So again, in Seattle, I just talked about where I went to an event in Burien. But do I, in Seattle, I can live in Capitol Hill or I live in the Central District? And what pictures does that begin to bring up for people? Do I live in the University District or do I live in the Laurel Purse, which is a very affluent, wealthy area on the other side of the University of Washington? Do I live in my neighborhood? There's a very distinct way people talk about it. I actually have fallen into the cultural norm. I live in the Rainier Valley. Technically, I live in Rainier Beach, but more specifically, the people in my neighborhood, we live in Upper Rainier Beach compared to Rainier Beach. And so again, my practicing vulnerability and disclosing, I'm like, wow, I have actually bought into how we talk about the area when at the end of the day, I live in the Rainier Valley like everyone else does. And then there's low-income housing, or do I live in an urban high-rise? And both of those can begin to get mixed in the areas. Just think about downtown, if you walk around downtown, there's a lot of low-income housing mixed right in the middle, right next door, across the street from urban high-rises. Also, a lot of conversation then about geographic locations, about attached or detached homes. Am I someone who lives in a trailer park? Or am I someone who lives in a mobile home park? And what was interesting when I began to think about, and I actually called from home in Kentucky, and I asked one of my family members, who actually lives in what is called a mobile home, and I asked her what the difference was. And she said to me, well, a trailer park, you have little to no space. People are right on top of one another, and they're very poor. And I said, but I know that you don't have a lot of money, so what's it like living in a mobile home? She goes, well, I have to pay more for my property, and I have space and lawns and flowers. And that's how you know the difference. And then, in fairness, I, of course, didn't ask her if I could use her name, so I won't use her name. But, and I said, well, what's the difference? And she goes, well, trailer park people are just a little more trashy. And I thought, wow, that's really interesting. That was pretty much my comment. So communication of classism. It's all in fashion magazines, the do's and don'ts. We can actually change our class by what we put on in clothing and what we take off in clothing. Wherever we shop, do we shop in grocery stores? the only people that are supposed to be thin in Appalachia are women. Men are supposed to be heavier. And so we communicate classism in that way, so other cultures have those meanings. Again, am I a redneck or a blue blood? When all of our blood is blue, but where do I come from? And do I have a new or used car? Is it a brand car? Is it an off-brand car? These are other ways that we communicate classism. We also do it in social mobility. So there's upward mobility. Is someone supposed to marry well? In education, where did you go to school? How high? What is your college level? And then class passing. A very public and very famous class passing story comes from Oprah Winfrey herself. I encourage you to look at how she was seen as being judged by having a working mother who was a housekeeper, and how they passed class. And she tells a really beautiful story, so I encourage you to look up her story. But also I thought about the political character, Ava Perón. And Ava Perón was actually accused of class trespassing. She was seen, as an actress, and not someone who was meant to socialize with the upper crust, and was treated very poorly when she, of course, married Juan Perón. And so class trespassing story as well. So I knew tonight we would be closer on time and run short, because I wanted to just have a conversation with those of you who are here about next steps. But of all the things that I've done on the web along with the video, reflection, do you think we're reading to think about the course? How does your experience of class affect how you see the world? In what ways do the privileges of meritocracy affect your story? I have some handouts, as usual. A couple of them are stories, and then one of them is a song from Tracy Chapman. You can YouTube that as well, so that you can listen to her song. It's called Mountain of Things, and it really is, I think, a really beautiful way to tell a story about the concept of class, to where she goes on by the end of this song. She talks about having big, expensive cars and fancy things, but that the ultimate goal will be to bury herself in the ground and surround herself with all those mountain things to be protected. Some readings. There's a reading on class power and privilege. So what thoughts come to mind when you consider the haves and have-nots, and which group do you most identify with? Divided and Falls, another reading on the St. Mark's website, /resources. It says, so in what ways does internalized classism impact your narrative? When have you seen yourself as the oppressed and the oppressor? There's a really great series a number of years ago from the New York Times called Class Matters. And I found this to be a really, really neat series. So a team of reporters spent more than a year exploring the ways that class, defined as a combination of income, education, wealth, and occupation, influences destiny in a society that likes to think of itself as the land of unbounded opportunity. And I think this really will speak to a lot of people, and I encourage you to, the slides, of course, are posted as well. You may be able to find this link and go look at this New York Times resource. So ultimately, what I really wanted to do tonight was try to have a few words or conversation, because when I thought about the course and interacted with people like Jennifer and Steve Thomason, who was part of the Wisdom School Planning Series, I know, and having attended the Wisdom School Series, that are a 4 to 5 week offering, that's a big request to ask people to come every week. And it's not surprising that the number of people start to dwindle off, because it's a big commitment. But what I thought about that is that, well, what do we do next, or what do we hope to do? And I thought a simple after-action review, and this could be a very open, dialogical conversation. So what did I intend to have happen for this offering? It was really just to simply create space so that people could find ways to create their own story and figure out how to share their story through all of these socially constructed optics of race, ethnicity, sex, sexuality, gender, disability, ableism, and class. But when I ask you if you can share with me, or if it's not something that's in your mind and you want to spend some time thinking about it, you can email me. And on my email, if you'd like to email me at some point, so it's SEA for Seattle, and then RN for registered nurse, and then Bob, B-O-B, at AOL.com. So SEARNBOB at AOL.com. So what I would invite you to do is, what actually happened? This is what I wanted to happen. and what I thought about sharing. But what really happened for you, who was able to come to all of the series, some of the series, part of the series, your first time in the series? And so just spend a minute, if anyone has any thoughts that just come to you, but I welcome any emails that you might send to me, or you virtually, you can email me as well.
Thank you. And so I really appreciate this story because, you know, there's a lot more complexity in the individual instances, right, that we have of all of these things that we've been talking about that maybe wouldn't be seen if you were just doing the theory. You know what I mean?
And that was part of my intention, because it was also to, much like the additional handouts that I have for people, and the handouts are also on the website if you want to go back to see the previous classes and plus all the portions that were videotaped, is to expose people to different ways of storytelling, right? So we've had poetry, we've had spoken word, we had just a traditional oral oratory, just someone telling their story as it speaks to them. And I think it's really about finding that space of authenticity for yourself and then to communicate that. But for some people, you know, I acknowledge, you know, whether it's a collage or writing music or writing some prose down or poetry or spoken word or interpretive dance, there are so many ways to express ourselves, and trying to offer that in different ways to people so that they can then take some of that didactic information and wrap their head around it in a different way. And so it's good. It sounds like I've accomplished some of the things that I had intended. So that actually happened. And really, you know, because the group is now small, I really do have a suggestion. My suggestion is that we pause next week, because I think it takes time for people to begin to, whether it be put pen to paper, or begin to work back to, you know, to turn the story around in a week. It is a big crunch. My thinking for next is, you know, a follow-up on whether it be in the wisdom school or some other way to think about, even if it's just offering anyone who's attended the series to come together and have a talking circle. Like, I'm just really open to what would people like to have happen next, if anything, right? Because people might just want to go away and be with their thoughts for some time. And as you see me around, let me know. Or email me again as to what you might like to see next. Because one person, for example, said to me in week one, there's so much depth and breadth in the didactic content, you can have an entire day of a conversation about race and ethnicity. Absolutely. These are just skimming the surface. And then maybe I'd like to think going just a little bit deeper in some of the concepts, because we may not have had to think about them. So, what would people like to see next? If anything.
I think this is connected to the question you just asked, but throughout this classes and discussion, I just keep remembering that when I lived on Mercer Island for 13 years, which is a very statistically wealthy community, how even people who lived on Mercer Island divided up the island into better places to live, you know, where the better families or safer places to live. Mainly it was about safety. And it made me wonder about how much of human nature, I mean, I know the isms are a form of tyranny, of power exerted onto oppressed, and part of our spiritual work that we talk about here is how do we recognize our role in that and how do we act to shift it. And all of that is really good conversation, and alongside of that, I feel like there's a conversation about the fact that everybody is afraid of something. And how do we ally, or how do we appropriate these things to assuage that existential anxiety or fear that everybody has, regardless of where they fit racially, class-wise, gender-wise, etc. That feels to me like what I hear when I hear someone tell their story is it's not just the content, the intellectual content, it's the hard work that they do emotionally and spiritually to figure out how it makes sense of making meaning out of their lives. But that's the part that feels most exciting to me.
And I have a great appreciation for that. And honestly, if I had, I'd call it a secondary, what do I intend to have happen? I hope by just engaging in this series in a slightly different way, right? Because we can all find, Seattle has a lot of resources to attend, you know, how to talk to your racist uncle, how to, you know, all these different forums to go deeper into learn some more skills. But because I, inside in my head, and growing up in a very oral storytelling tradition in Appalachia, storytelling is the way we really communicate whatever is deep. It is so deep and profound and personal. And it becomes frightening to let that out because it might be filled with rage and or sadness or profound grief. And for me, it's trying to figure out my secondary intention really was, is there space for a next conversation that takes us a little bit deeper on that journey in a safe space? And that certainly would really excite me, because I feel like that's the work I still have to do. Because and I think I'm ready to go deeper, I just need a safe space to do that. Yeah, Chris?
I was thinking along those same lines, and I would have said too, about there is some fear. It may be a barrier, at least I feel like it is for me at times when I'm writing poetry or a song or something where I'm expressing myself. There tends to be a barrier to let that out somehow. You know, I might be afraid of my own story or something. But then I think that's sort of one aspect of it, is getting your story down on paper or at least sort of collecting your thoughts. But then to actually share it with someone in a safe environment is a really, I mean, that is what you're given here in this space. And it was just so evident that the people who did share that they really had taken the time to get down to that really good stuff that can be kind of frightening, or, you know, the real stuff, but then to be able to give it to us in a way that enriches all of us. It's pretty powerful. So I think the space has been really good for that.
So would people that are here today, because right now it's kind of a democracy, right? So would we agree that this kind of conversation requires more time and energy, whether it's putting it into paper or creating the interpretive dance or breaking out your drums or whatever that is, that there needs to be time for that, and that somehow I'll put on my creative thinking hat and engage with probably Jennifer and Malcolm and those of you that I see here and will continue to see around. Those of you who check in virtually, think about what a next space might look like, and I'm happy to take the lead and develop that. I always feel like I can run with something and people give me some idea and direction. I can kind of put it together and kind of marshal that or shepherd that. And we'll just take a pause for next week, because I think it does take time and depth and breath. And then if you would allow me, since we have about 15 minutes, a couple of weeks ago I handed out my own piece of spoken word poetry. And it was easy to hand it out. And I did think to myself, I should practice vulnerability by example. And so I am going to share my own piece of spoken word. And for those of you who weren't able to hand it out, I'll give you a little bit of context behind this piece. Something bad needs to happen to you for you to be gay. And really even ultimately is about how I chose to use my agency, which is my own internal sense of power, to still be present to people who say things that I feel are hurtful, but also how I really made a very conscious decision to do the best I can, to be the best version of myself, to use all of my privileges responsibly. So my whiteness, my maleness, my upper middle classness, you know, all of these advantages I have in the world, and so that becomes my work, and that's the journey I'm on now. So having said that, this piece is called Requiem for Myself. About the age of 14, my identity had changed, and at the same time, you and my daddy named me fag, queer, sissy, fruit, fairy, and panty waist. Naming flashed across your faces as you saw me. In the here and now politically correct world, you wear an unmistakable expression of silent judgment as I watch your lip curl and your brow anger and distaste of me. I have wasted a great deal of my existence prying myself in the weight of your arms and legs that oppress me, constantly at war and feeling distressed. Often, I did the wrong thing and repressed my identity. In an effort to make you comfortable now, I will not dim my light. With a smile, the others always asking that I join their group. With a tilt of their heads, we just want to get to know who you are. But what you're really asking me to do right now is debase myself for your acceptance. I used to live in the world before I came to know that your smiles and the tilts of your heads are such a rip-off, and the mask of your disingenuousness is a setup. I have learned to make allowances for the socially distorted realities that makes the other distance me from them, and into Saki Shambhavi's rainbow-colored girls remind me that I can't seem to hear anything anymore, except for the maddening screams and the soft strains of the impending death of my soul, which is odd because I have already died in a real way. So this is a requiem for myself, because the ancient clarity of my spirit refuses to accept my repression and the other's oppression. In case social distortions are wrong and in reality you still want me to join your group, take a seat amongst the noetic congregation and prepare yourself for the testament of who I am. As a child growing up in Kentucky, the preacher shouted every Sunday, "Make a joyful noise unto the Lord." Not a song, but a living out loud noise. With that in mind, I scream. I am the sound of my own voice. I am the infinite beauty of my soul. I am the spirit of hubris that seems to offend the other. I am a memory, no, a wound to every other who is arrogant enough to keep distance between me, my clan, and our collective humanity. I am the wrath of battered sisters who hide in the shadows of windows. I am the fear of homophobic deadbeats with blood-stained weapons. I am the anger of brothers living with and having died from AIDS. I am the sorrow of Matthew Shepard. I am the guilt of repression. No one should have to suffer to reach his or her destiny. I am the accountant of exploitations about which I ledger systematically in an effort to remember that I am history, unfortunately repeating itself. So I will raise my voice. I will use the agency of my socioeconomic class and my race. I will march with pride to the syncopated rat-tat-tat-tat steps of my clan. I will scream and I will holler. I will break the barriers and the walls which the other created to maintain illusionary distance. I will not be sorry, nor will I apologize for being myself. Temporally, you ask me to come into the temple of the other, because it is in the best interest of the group that you get to know me. Upon acceptance of your invitation, do not expect me to crawl. For who I am is you, not binary, but tired of struggle, weary from the social constructs that suffocate, with no respite from reality, at the end of the day, both of us crying ourselves to sleep. questions in the interest of that vulnerability. And that was a lot harder than I imagined because it was written 10 years ago, but I mean, that is the power of stories. And I think that to tell them has tremendous healing power. And it also has tremendous powers of reconciliation, which I think is that it is our work as a spiritual community. So it has been an honor and privilege, yes.
Well, it is an honor and privilege to hear your story and for you to have gathered the people you've gathered to share their stories. I wonder, how is it different to tell that, to read that now, in this place, or after having taught this?
Sure. I think what's different now is I have a sense of groundedness in my own sense of agency to use my voice. And I guess ultimately, a space can be created for other people to tell their stories. There's something just very powerful in that for me. And what's different is that the pain is an interesting kind of deep space. It's more of a memory, and how a memory, I feel like, will flood us in unexpected moments. But it doesn't have the power, and I don't really have the anger that I had in it. Because when I wrote that, I was so angry. And that was my response. However, the way I handled the actual situation at the time, I journaled about it, because we had to keep a journal in this class and turn it into the instructor. And she called me in and asked me if they needed to call the ombudsman, because they considered it to be an act of violence against me. And what I said, and this was still very early in my own connection with the church as a community, because I said, well, I just think that would be wrong, and somehow what I need to do is still be present to this person. I still need to figure that out. And so that really just began this lifelong journey, and in public forums where I attended wisdom schools or weekend offerings, and I go, I have to remind myself, even though I'm angry, Donald Trump is a child of God. And trust me, that is really hard sometimes, to keep yourself in that space or to turn back to that space. But the change is, that's where I'm ready to reconcile my own isms, be present in the other isms of other people, and even if they're directed at me. Like, I have the ability to do that now in a way that I was just discovering 10 years ago.
The power of your voice when you expressed refusal to apologize resonates with me. I feel I'm a straight person, so I'm dealing with other isms than what you dealt with here. But it resonates with me in my experience of how I have needed to refuse to be different because someone else wants me to be. And that points to how we can draw closer to each other regardless of our diverse experiences, who we are in life. We can draw closer when we share at that level, because somewhere in there, somebody else's experience, somebody else's felt experience is going to feel very much like our own.
Thank you for that. And I think at the end of the day, I think we are more similar than dissimilar. At the end of the day, our collective humanity, I think we want to desire
I guess I'm just reflecting on, or a question would be, you wrote this 10 years ago and you were very upset, angry at the time. Do you think, or how would you describe the act of writing it itself and helping you to process some of that, those feelings?
For me, it definitely was cathartic, because it allowed me to focus what I'll just call all this bundle of energy that needed to come out. And those of you who have attended the Enneagram workshops, I identify as number one, a perfectionist. And what happens with the Enneagram, E-N-N-E-G-R-A-M? A-G-R-A-M. And the perfectionist relative, but the perfectionist can tend to get a little bit into this, and I'm not allowed to show anger, because that means I'm bad. So it was a way for me to channel that anger that wouldn't hurt anyone else, or have me directed at anyone else, but I could still be angry and get it out. Yes,
this is Mona.
Thanks for attending.